find the antiderivative of the 1 divided by 1 minus 2 sine x, first you want to use the substitution. U is equal to tangent of x divided by 2. So that if you solve for x using the arctangent, you will get x is equal to 2 arctan of u. Okay, so basically take the arctangent of both sides. You're going to get x over 2 is equal to arctan of u, right? And then solve for x, you will get x is equal to twice the arctan of u. Okay, so the dx, because we need a dx for this integral, is going to be 2 over 1 plus u squared du. Okay, 2 is taken outside, you don't differentiate it, but the derivative of the arctan is 2 divided by 1 plus u squared du. Now, how do you find the sine x? Well, sine x is equal to, you're going to use the right triangle. Notice that sine x, we're going to take the sine of both sides, right? So sine of 2 arctan u is going to be, using the double angle formula for the sine, you know that it's going to be 2 sine of arctan multiplied by the cosine of arctan. Right? We know this from the double angle formula, right? Sine of 2x, for example, is equal to 2 sine x cosine x, right? So that's exactly what this is. So 2 times the sine of arctangent multiplied by the cosine of arctangent. Now, what is going to be the arctangent of u? Arctangent of u means angle whose tangent is u, right? So suppose that this is the angle, and tangent is going to be u, right? Opposite divided by the adjacent. And it must be 1, right? Because u over 1 is u, precisely. Right? So arctangent of u is angle whose tangent is u divided by 1, opposite over adjacent. Right? This is the tangent, u divided by 1. So now, what is going to be the third side? Using the Pythagorean theorem, we know that the third side is u squared plus 1 under the square root. Right? So sine of this angle now, sine is going to be opposite over hypotenuse. Right, so u divided by square root of u squared plus 1 times the cosine. The cosine is adjacent over hypotenuse. 1 over square root u squared plus 1. Right, so as a result, what do we get? 2u divided by the square root goes away, and the inside is what remains. 1 plus u squared. So that's the sine x. Beautiful. So now we can actually substitute this into what we have. So let's find the dx first. The dx is 2 divided by 1 plus u squared. Let's leave the du until the end. Now multiplied by 1 over 1 minus 2, and what is sine x? This guy, right? 2u 1 plus u squared, and now we can put a du. Now let's separate this work because this was meant for substitutions. So now what do we get? Simplifying this, we should get 2 integral 1 over 1 plus u squared multiplied by 1 over 1 plus u squared minus 4u over 1 plus u squared du. Now this simplifies as what? This simplifies as 2 integral 1 over 1 plus u squared. So we know that this 1 plus u squared will go on the top, right? And this bottom remains u squared minus 4u plus 1 du. So look what happens. The 1 plus u squares, they cancel out. So in the end, we have this. U squared minus 4u plus 1 du. Okay, so there's no other way but to actually use the integration by partial fractions. We know that we can actually factor this. We know that, and I'm going to do the work here. We can factor u squared minus 4u plus 1 by realizing that we need two numbers, the product of which will give us positive 1, and the sum of which will give us negative 4. So the trick to do that is to first write, first realize that we're going to need exact two identical numbers whose sum will be negative 4. And that's going to be negative 2 and negative 2. Now the second number, and realize that you can't factor this using integers or whole numbers. That's why there's a trick here. The factors will involve roots, square roots. So the first thing is to realize that you need two identical integers. So negative 2 plus negative 2 gives us negative 4, right? The sum here. Now the next thing is to use roots. And we're going to put a number here, and going to be the same number under this root as well. But since the square roots must be gone when we're talking about the sum, obviously they have to have different signs, right? So for the second one, we have to have a negative sign. Now let's think of the numbers. If we think of 1, if we think of 1 to be put under the square root, look what's going to happen. 1 is not going to work, right? Because square root of 1 is exactly 1, right? And we know that when we're talking about square roots, we're going to have numbers inside other than the 1. We're going to have 2, 3, 4, 5, right? So that's already, that's a no-no, right? 1 is not going to work. What about 2? If you put 2 in there and check your sum, the sum will give us negative 4, but the product will not give us negative 4. Right? The product is going to give us negative 2 plus 4, which is going to give us positive 2, right? Not plus 1, but plus 2, right? So the 2 under the square root does not work. How about the 3? If we test the 3, you're going to see if you multiply these guys to check if you get positive 1 here, you will get what? You will get minus 3, because the square roots are gone. That's the first product using the FOIL method, right? Minus 3, and then the opposite signs, they make sure that the square roots are gone, which is great, right? And then plus 4, right? So minus 3 plus 4, bingo, plus 1, right? So this are your factors. And again, the first way to do this would be to introduce the identical two numbers, integers or whole numbers. Well, in this case, integers, because they're negative. Identical, in this case negative 2 plus negative 2 gives us the sum of negative 4, and make sure that you have square roots and exactly the same numbers inside and opposite signs. Opposite signs so that negative 4 is only satisfied by the negative 2 plus negative 2, and these square roots will not take part, in other words, in the sum as a result. Right? And we checked starting from 1, then we checked 2, then we checked 3, that 3 is indeed the number inside the square root that will make sure that we will get the product of 1. Okay? So the product is going to be 1 of these two factors, and the sum of these two factors will be negative 4. Bingo! So you found the factors. So now that you found the factors, you realize that this, using the partial fraction decomposition, you're going to have a over u plus radical 3 minus 2 plus b over u minus 3, I'm sorry, minus radical 3 minus 2. Okay, multiplying both sides of this equation by this denominator, we'll get 1 is equal to a times u minus radical 3 minus 2 plus b times u plus radical 3 minus 2. Okay? So now if you check the coefficients here, starting with the constant on the left side is 1, so 1 is equal to 1 is equal to what? This part here, minus radical 3 minus 2, that's a constant, right? So minus radical 3 minus 2 times a plus the constants here for the b, right? So radical 3 minus 2 times b. Okay, and now checking the second one, basically the u now, right? Checking the variable u to the first power. The left side doesn't have the variable u, so we're going to have 0 on the left side. And then we're going to have what? We're going to have a, right? Because a multiplies the u. And then b plus b, right? So a plus b. So now how do we solve this? Notice that we can eliminate a using these two equations. If we multiply the second equation by positive radical 3 plus 2 and then add the two resulting equations, a will be eliminated, right? So we're going to multiply both sides of this equation by positive radical 3 plus 2. Right, and then add these two equations. Right, add these two equations together. So look what's going to happen. A will be eliminated, right? Because we made sure that the opposite signs to those numbers will be multiplied to the A. Therefore, eliminating A when we add these two equations. Right, so 1 plus 0 is, 0 is not changed, right? So 0 remains 0. 1 plus 0 is 1. A is eliminated, great, and look what happens to B. Radical 3 plus radical 3 is 2 radical 3. Minus 2 plus 2 is 0, right? So it's just 2 radical 3B. So B is equal to what? B is equal to 1 over 2 radical 3. So A is, using this second equation, and don't use the equation that we got as a result of altering it, just use this equation, the original second equation. B is 1 over 2 radical 3, so A is going to be the conjugate, the opposite of that, right? The negated version of that, because the sum of these two is 0, right? So A must be the negative of this, negative 1 over 2 radical 3, bingo. So now we can use this to solve the integral. So we're going to have 2. What is a? A is this, right? So how about we actually put everything together? So we have negative, right? Because a is negative. That's going to be the first integral. So a is negative. So negative 2 over 2 radical 3, right? 2 radical 3 integral. So we already put a, right? Here. Negative 1 over 2 radical 3. So 1 over u plus radical 3 minus 2 du. Now the second integral has b positive, right? So it's going to be plus 2 over 2 radical 3 integral. 1 over, and what is the denominator here? U minus radical 3 minus 2. U minus radical 3 minus 2 du. So now what's going to happen? The 2's get cancelled out, so we have a simpler integral, right? 1 over root 3, 1 over u plus radical 3 minus 2 du. Plus 1 over root 3, 1 over u minus radical 3 minus 2 du. Using the V substitution, you know that if you set v is equal to this, dv is going to be 1, right? So that's easy. There's nothing, no numbers to be multiplied whatsoever, right? In both cases, right? Using any variable v, or this is z, for example, because this is a different denominator, right? This is v, this is z. In any case, dz or dv will not have anything but 1. 1 times du, right? So beautiful. So we can actually not show it, right? We can go straight to the ln, right? Because it's going to be ln of v in this case and ln of z in this case plus a constant, right? So 1 over root 3. And since it's the same number here for these two integrals, let's put it outside and keep it common. So ln of u plus radical 3 minus 2. And sorry, I forgot the sign here, didn't I? This is going to be a negative sign, right? So this is a negative sign. So how about we actually do start with a positive, because then we can subtract, right, the first one from the second one. So let's start with a positive. Ln of u minus radical 3 minus 2 minus ln, right, because the minus sign here, minus ln of this. And actually, I have to use the absolute bars, because the inputs can be negative as a result of the u, right? U is not squared, so we have to use the absolute value bar. So ln of absolute value bar, right, minus ln of the absolute value bar of this denominator. U plus radical 3 minus 2 absolute value bar plus a constant. So now we can combine these two in one fraction, right? We can set 1 over root 3 ln absolute value of the fraction, right? Because we know that the properties of logarithms, when you subtract two logarithms, you can basically make the input of the first one be the numerator, and then the input of the second one be the denominator, right? All under the absolute value bar plus a constant, right? So basically what I'm saying is you're going to have this one be, and by the way, let's put the u in terms of x, because that's going to be the final answer in terms of x. What is going to be the u? Tan of x over 2, right? So tan of x over 2 minus radical 3 minus 2 over tan of x over 2, right, substituting back x over 2, plus radical 3 minus 2, plus radical 3 minus 2, right? I know this is a heavy exercise, but if you do this correctly, you should get this antiderivative as your final answer. If you got it, it means all your work was correct. Congratulations, and thanks so much for watching this video. I hope this was a lot of fun, and see you in the next one.